The program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Hello and welcome on another magical good afternoon to all of you and welcome on the Sunset Safari. My name is Jamie. This afternoon I have Viam on camera with me and we are coming to you live from Juma, Arethusa, and that sun's very bright, Cheetah Plains Game Reserve in the Sabi Sand in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa. I did not think that through. Now, not only are we live, but we are also interactive, which means that you can send through your questions on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can email through. Just let me blink away the damage to my retinas. You can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. And now we're going to look back at the Buffalo Bulls so that I don't have to blink into the glaring hot African sun. It's another startlingly hot afternoon. It's been an odd October this year in the African Lowveld. One of the coldest, I think, on record. And yet today it's skyrocketed up to 36 degrees centigrade, which is 96 degrees Fahrenheit. These buffalo seem to be handling it relatively well, although I'm sure they're thinking quite keenly on the idea of going to find a mud wallow somewhere. That being said, the buffalo of Juma have been treading particularly, or have to tread particularly carefully at the moment, since the Nkuhumas have made Juma their home. That is a pride of 5 lionesses and 8 little cubs that they have to keep fed and happy. And they are probably about a kilometre or so north of these buffalo bulls. Oh, and cows, sorry. There's actually 2 lonely cows as part of this herd. I can't tell if this is just the tail end of a larger herd, or if we've just stumbled upon a splinter group that perhaps has been separated from the main breeding herd by the lions themselves. Now, there's a male lion, probably about 500 meters north of where this buffalo herd is going. Well, that could be interesting, although when I passed him at the end of the sunrise safari, he didn't look as though he was going to be up to terribly much, and as I said, it is very, very hot here. Now, it has been exciting times here on Juma and, well, actually in the entire northern Sabi Sand over the last 2 days. We've had an extraordinary number of cat sightings, and after a prolonged absence of our spotted cats, our leopard characters, they all seem to have made a reappearance at the same time. Is that buffalo wet? Is that mud? Yes, it is mud. Okay, so they have been wallowing in the mud. Must have just come up from Twin Dams. Yesterday we had a quarantine, the male leopard, on a kudu kill. And when Brent returned to him yesterday on the Sunset Safari, he stumbled across a Tundi, the female leopard with 2 tiny little cubs. And then, of course, Karula's been in the Mwati drainage line with her 2 gorgeous cubs. And we enjoyed an amazing time with them on the Sunrise Safari this morning. Absolutely stunning light. It really was. I mean, if you missed the Sunrise Safari, we had the most incredible sighting. They looked as though they had halos, all 3 of them. Truly one of the most beautiful leopard sightings I've ever experienced. I'm on the new road, by the way. There's an obstruction. Oh my goodness gracious. Watch out, Liam. Okay. We're going to go rushing up to Buffelshoek Dam, see what's happening there. In the meantime, there is somebody else who would like to say hello. Let's head across to Brent and his trip around Arethusa.
Well, my name is Brent Leo Smith and I'm living up to the Leo in my surname. We have some lions. Lions that are not the Nkuhuma pride. Shock, horror. We're on a live African safari. And believe it or not, I didn't even know they were here. I was on my way to another surprise when I saw next to the road. Hello, kitties. I haven't seen you in a long time. You lot have grown up a lot. Naughty boys. Don't look at me like that. Naughty boys. These are not lions we see too often up here in the north. Who can tell me which lions are these? If you know the answer, hashtag Safari Live on Twitter or questions@wildearth.tv. Who are these young upstarts? Now, of course, it is the heat of the day. There are two lionesses and three young males here. There's one of the lioness. And they're looking very hot and heavy. It is, of course, the hottest day of the season so far. And I've been going on about how cool October's been. So October came to say hello. This afternoon it is a 36 degrees Celsius, 92 Fahrenheit, and we are in the sun with that. Oh, I'm not going to tell you, Pride. Well done, Liz. It is indeed the Salila Pride. Oh, forgot my sunglasses on. Naughty Brent. As I said, I didn't know these lions were here when I drove around the corner. Yes, here we go. Salila lions. Lovely surprise. Not what my plan was. I've got another surprise that I'm going to try get to. I'm going to leave these lions now because we'll come back to them. There's going to be a little bit more pressure on the other sighting. So I want to get in there before all the other game drives are out so we can spend as much time as possible with the other surprise. But we will come back to the Salila lions shortly. And I've got lots of stories to tell you about them. Bye, guys. So while we dash off to the next surprise, and it is a real surprise, I would not have dismissed the Salilas so quickly if there wasn't something very special down the road. Let's go back to Jamie while I try find the next surprise.
Oh, surprises up everyone's sleeve this afternoon, including for that poor giraffe who just got chased unceremoniously away by a herd of elephants making their way towards the muddy wallows of Baboon Pan, which is to the south of us on Little Gowrie. And on this hot day, yes, you did very well. Well done for chasing the giraffe. You can be very proud of yourself, mister. On this boiling hot day, the elephants in particular will be feeling the heat. So a muddy wallow, or at least a muddy spraying, will be the best way to combat that. I love watching elephants do this. They have such fun spraying the mud up, coating their shoulders. Look at the mud spraying everywhere. Up on its ears, which is of course the best spot to get it, since that is where the skin is the thinnest and the blood vessels closest to the surface. Sorry, distraction in the form of elephants rumbling in all directions. Oh, down, right. None of this trunk nonsense. That's just wasting time. I'm now going to lie flat on my side in the mud. It's the best possible approach. Oh, somebody else is doing it too at the back. Oh, they are having such a ball. And this is where the hot days of Africa are truly extraordinary. One of my favorite things to watch. I always get excited when we go out on a hot afternoon in the hope that we're going to see this. And now look at them. Oh, other side, got to get a thorough all-round coating. Basically disappearing into the mud or feet kicking. You know, I'm almost tempted to join them. If I hadn't seen in the past what buffalo bulls do in that water, I might consider it, but perhaps not today. Makes for a very good ectoparasite remover, coating the ticks and parasites with mud. Oh, what's wrong? Why'd you chase him away? Little bit of an internal dispute between the members of this herd. Big female stepping forward to chase away another elephant. Oh, what a spectacular scene. and giraffe have hightailed it out of here. One elephant is trying to desperately to regain its footing in the slippery mud. And here comes more elephants on their way to join this happy mud party. Oh, and it's a little one. Oh, I love watching baby elephants do this. I wonder if perhaps we should reposition. Maybe try and move this leadwood tree out of our way. Comes a massive female bringing up the rear. Oh, what fun on a hot afternoon. The only way to deal with it. Little one. Uh-oh, slippery, slippery. The little baby's feet splaying out. Hasn't quite got the weight advantage of the adults, and not quite the trunk coordination either. Somewhat piddly attempts at tossing mud. Oh, shame. Shame, it's thirsty as well. Oh, photobomb. By one other very muddy elephant. And that's definitely going to put them in a slightly better mood. Much cooler now. Thick mud takes a lot longer to dry than just using water, which means that the cooling effect lasts for even longer. Another nice explanation behind an elephant's wrinkly skin traps all of that mud there, and that means in turn that it takes even longer to dry. Oh, look, it's playing with a bone on the right there. Or was. Decided that's not terribly interesting. Kick. Ha. Seems as though Gowrie Main is the place to me, place to be. Just bear with me one moment. I just want to give Henry an update. Oh, hold on. Andrew's doing it for me. Little baby. Little baby still wants to go in and have a proper mud wallow, but is too nervous to do that without mom's direct supervision. Look at this. Oh, let's go over across to Brent, see what he's got for you.
Look at that. It is the biggest male leopard in the Sabi Sands. Hi, guys. So I'm being mocked by the vehicle next to me, guys. But don't worry, I don't mind. So the Anderson male leopard. So Aaron in New Zealand guessed what it was. It was indeed Mr. Anderson. Now he does have a kill around here somewhere. I'm not exactly sure where, but it looks like he's on the move. He might be going for a drink. There's the kill. Oh, he's got himself a big warthog. I mean, literally, he looks like a lioness. He's so big. This is so exciting. This is only my second sighting ever, and Jandre's second sighting ever of a Mr. Anderson. I'm going to stop now, and you can just see that beast walk through the bush. Where's my camera, John? Where's my camera? I have to take pictures of Mr. Anderson. So he is a really, really big male leopard, pushing probably around 90 kilos. So close on 200 pounds. And this is the furthest to the east I've ever seen him. Oh, he's decided he's going to lie down. Look at that, isn't that incredible? I'm just going to wait a little bit. We're going to get a little bit closer shortly. But as I said, there's going to be quite a lot of pressure on the sighting, so we don't have too much time. That's why I was rushing here, and then the Tsalala pride popped out. Now, this, as I keep saying, for me, October is by far the best month of the year to come on safari in Africa. The game viewing is absolutely fantastic. If we just think about what we've seen this month, and how frequently we've seen the big cats this month. It's absolutely incredible. Chai Connie says this is her first time seeing Mr. Anderson. Can I tell her about him? Of course I can. This is only my second time. He's got very distinctive eyes. Slightly slitted. There we go. He's on the move again. He might be just heading for a drink, but he probably won't leave that warthog carcass too long in case something else might want to steal it, like a vulture. That's a big adult warthog. Even a big male, like, I think he could probably hoist it, but he's just being lazy. Now, this big boy apparently was born in Mala Mala to the Ngobazwan female. Probably quite far from, he's quite far from his natal range. And he's growing. It's definitely the biggest leopard I've ever seen in the Sabi Sands. Now that used to belong to the Camp Pan male, that title. But I personally think after looking at photographs of them at the same age, I think Mr. Anderson is bigger than the Camp Pan male. He's gone into a little thicket. I'm just going to try to scoop around it. And I'm trying to think, he's probably about eight or nine years old now. When he arrived up here in the Northern Sabi Sands, he was very, very skittish. He is still not the most relaxed leopard, so we always just go a little bit easy. Well, the second time I've seen him, but from when I speak to the guys, I just go a little bit easy around him. And as I said, it looks like he might be heading straight to Arethusa camp for a drink. Stop now. Now, Samina would like to know why he's called Anderson. Samina, I would be lying if I said I did. I'm afraid I do not. You can maybe ask Ryan, who's in the sighting with me, why he's called Anderson. Here he is. Now, let's just have a good look at him. You can see that massive head and dewlap. And you can see those slightly slanted eyes. Very, very distinct of this male leopard. I hope you guys are getting some screenshots. I'm gonna have to snap away. This is, as I said, the second time I've ever seen him. And the first time he was lying down. He was too lazy to even stand up for us. Can see that big head, that big neck. Now, Liz would like to know, how do I compare his size to Tingana? I'd say he's a little bit taller and a little bit heavier. I just need to be on the radio for a second. Can you still see him? I'll just move so you can see him. Ryan. Ryan, as soon as any of your guys want to get in here, I'm happy to make space. Thanks a lot. Perfect. Cool, perfect. Right, he's been heading into some thick areas, and of course our vehicles are different. Ryan's in a much longer vehicle, we're in a short vehicle. So we're going to go on the area where it's a little bit more difficult to move in our short vehicle, and Ryan's going to go on the one side. So we're going to keep with them. There could be a little pan or something in the little dry river system up ahead that he's heading to have a drink at. So Ryan's kindly given us some extra time here. He says he'll let us know, but he's happy for us to stay. So very exciting. Oh, hello, big boy. I didn't even see him go down. He's just stopped in the shed. Now Roger is wondering if he's sired any known leopards. He's thought to have sired Tiani, whose Salahesh is current cub. Well, she's not really a cub anymore. She's over a year old. Oh, bless you, Mr. Anderson. Now, as I said, asking about the size difference between him and Tingana, he's bodily sized a lot bigger. I'd say probably Tingana weighs about 80 kilograms. And Anderson probably 90 to 95 kilograms. He is an absolute beast. He's mated with Karula, Shadow, Tandi, Salahesh. I think that's all I know of. And there's obviously Moyo and other females that occur to the west of us. And he's originally pushed Tingana out of what was his territory. Yeah, I'm just going to paddle forward a tiny bit. That good fusion there. There we go. So, as I said, he's pushed Tingana further to the east, so, and Tingana then pushed Mvula. Mvula has pretty much lost most of his territory, and that whole scenario started with the Anderson male coming into Tingana's territory. Now, he seems to be an expert warthog killer. Well, a lot of male leopards are, but he takes very big, very, very big warthogs. Now, as I just mentioned, he's mated with Karula, Shadow, Tandi, and Marjorie in Texas was wondering that. So it's even possible that he could have sired little Hosana and Shungile. But, as I said, it's almost impossible to know the male lineage of leopards without genetic study. You can see his very distinctive face. You see, he's quite hot and uncomfortable with his full belly. Very difficult light at the moment. Oh, look at that. Sorry about all the clicks, guys. This is the first time I've got to get any photos of the Anderson. Hopefully I'm not too excited that they're all blurry. Yes, if they were blurry, Eggsy would be very proud. Now those lions were not far from here. Okay, so we got Eggsy, who's in final control, says, if I've got any blurry photographs, much applause. Now, Safari Ginny is wondering, what is Mr. Anderson's spot pattern? It's difficult to see, but let's have a look on the monitor. He looks like a 3-4, but let me check on the camera when he's not panting. It's a 3-3, or no, it's a 3-4. You see a little spot up higher? And a 3, so right 3. Always start with the right hand side. Was there two little spots there on the top? What do you think, Jean-André? Spots or dirt? Dirt. I'd say he's a 3-4. You can almost see, you see his tongue there. We always talk about how rough a big cat's tongue is. You can actually see those little rasps on his tongue. And look how beautiful his canines are. You can see he's in prime condition. There's no cracks in those teeth. I mean, his incisors are even pearly white. You can see he does have the odd scratch and scar. And that is very common with male leopards. But he is an absolute beast. Very exciting to have been able to see him this afternoon. I said we'll stay as long as we possibly can. You can see he's not so happy October decided to come back with a vengeance. Emma says she's just joined the Safari Live family and just at the right time. So many wonderful sightings recently. I'm just very happy we got the Anderson. He doesn't look like he really cares whether we found him or not. What do you think, Jean-André? He looks a bit indifferent to us. Happy? Yes, no, I think that's definitely to do with the heat. He's quite a pale male. There was another very famous, very big pale male in the Sabi Sands in the last 15 or so years. He was called Pale Face, is our nickname for him. And he was the Manuleti male. So I thought he was born to Ngobozwan female. Apparently not. He was born to Mashapere female, who's the daughter of White Cloth. He's a very famous leopard from Mala Mala. Now, White Cloth open area is on the boundary of the northern Sabi Sands and of Mala Mala. It's, what's that? It's little Hoffman's. It's on Hoffman's boundary, which is below Little Gowrie. And so a reasonable distance from his natal area. But he went all the way west first before coming back through Ottawa. And he is a magnificent, magnificent male. Now, I've been regaled with many stories by my friends who see him more regularly out here, of him beating up hyenas. And he had a warthog kill stolen by hyenas, and he charged in and beat the hyenas up and took his kill back. He does look like a bit of a gangster. What do you think? So Eddie was actually wondering about that. Now, of course, Eddie, he's not going to take on a massive group of hyenas, but one or maybe two, he would definitely try and put a bit of fight on. I mean, we've even seen Mvula do that with Jamie. We've seen Konuma do it. Isn't this just spectacular? He is massive. Oh, chasing flies. And his teeth are in perfect condition. Still chasing flies. The flies are quite bad. That's probably one of the reasons he's not lying next to that carcass, is because of the flies. So, Kristen in North Carolina is wondering whether eye contact bothers the animals. Well, I'll show you. Not at all. And animals' eyes work, it's very bright out here, very differently to what owls do. So movement is what will bother them more than eye contact. So they see in sort of various shades of gray, and they don't see detail like we do. So what they'll pick up is movement rather than the detail of, they will never, probably with me wearing a cap like this, he won't even see my eyes. Now, also the way he's seeing the vehicle, I'm sure you can see the movement occasionally that Jean-André makes, and Jean-André is very good. He doesn't move fast, and neither do any of us sitting near him. That would annoy him. And the vehicle smells like petrol, and it's a big thing, but it doesn't smell like a potential threat or potential food. And vehicles have only been around for 100 years, and you must remember that animals are very instinctive. So he's had a million years of instinct telling him what to be scared of and what not to. Of course, in the beginning, quite often animals are scared, but if you keep habituating them and you drive carefully and respectfully and you don't over push them, they can become very relaxed. Now, this guy used to run from cars, and now you can see we're sitting 7-8 feet from him and he's just sleeping in the shade. You can see very hot, salivating quite heavily. Now, I'm trying to see, can we zoom more, Jean-André? Oh no, he's turned his head. Now when he turns his head, I just want to look at the back of the teeth to see if you can still see those little hard ridges. And it doesn't matter, I don't think he's going to turn his head again. Not a very attractive look for you, big man. Actually, I have to get a picture of that. The Anderson in all his glory. Okay, Jean-André, enough now. Well, Julia in Houston says he looks very big except for his feet. Now, his feet are big, Julia. I've had to track them, and his tracks are definitely bigger than Tingana's. I think it just could be the way he's lying at the moment. Oh, he's massive. Now, Chai Connie's asking, because he is so big, does that make him a little bit less efficient at climbing trees? Well, having not spent as much time with this leopard as a lot of the other leopards, I can't say for sure, although according to Tristan and the other guys up here, apparently he climbs like a demon and takes massive kills up trees. So it just depends on the individual. And as we see, Tingana doesn't seem to be the most adept in trees, but I think it just could be situational, and I don't think he's more affected by size than Tingana or Mvula, for example. There we go. I actually remember seeing those photographs. Vicky says he managed to haul a young giraffe up a tree, so I think he's probably okay at those tree things. Yes, I agree with you, Vicky. Okay, guys, we're gonna have to love and leave the Anderson for now. Lots of other guys are wanting to come in here now, and we have been lucky enough to spend this long with him. Hopefully he'll be around tomorrow as well. Okay, well, he's got his back to us. He's done with us. We're done with him. And we're going to move on, see what else we can find. There we go. One last glance over the shoulder before we leave. And so while we leave, oh, look away. That's a perfect time to go see what Jamie's been up to.
How exciting is that? I still haven't got to see Anderson, and it's definitely something I am really looking forward to. I'm just going to pull over so we can have a look at the zebra while we chat about what we've been up to over the last few minutes whilst Brent's been chilling out with Mr. Anderson. We have been back to check on Karula's Dacre kill. So for those of you who missed that, hello, no, don't panic. It's a zebra with muddy socks. Those of you who missed that update, Brent had Karula kill a Dacre on one of our live sunset safaris. She then set off to go and fetch the cubs after popping it in a large jackalberry tree. And when we found her the next morning, she was on an impala kill, not too far. Here we go. Relaxed a little bit. Not too far from where she had the impala kill. I'll continue that story in a moment. I'm really enjoying these muddy stockings. Look at that. Somebody's been wandering into one of the pans, probably to go and have a drink. Zebra, unlike buffalo and elephant, the animals that we've been with recently, they tend not to roll all the way in the mud. They love to roll in the dirt, and they'll roll all the way over on their backs, which most animals won't do. So what I mean by that is they'll start on one side and roll across and over. Other animals tend not to. Oh, look at that. Somebody's had a lucky escape. Oh, that to me, and I think we're often quick to jump to conclusions where zebra are concerned, that to me looks like this zebra had an escape from a lion. Don't you agree? Those look like claw marks. It looks like an animal trying to grab it and sliding down. Now generally, or often, huge scars on zebras' backs and flanks are actually usually caused by other zebra. They're quite aggressive animals with members of the same herd and with any intruders into their peaceful life. But that, I think, has come from a fortunate escape. You're looking at one of the luckiest zebra on Juma. And that could even have been an escape from the incredible Nkuhumas. We did hear zebra alarm calls a couple of days ago, although those wounds are not a couple of days old. Those are a lot older than that. Well done, zebra. I think you were very fortunate. And then, of course, with its cohort of oxpeckers, who are looking quite comical at the moment, because they are hot, so they're panting furiously. I mean, you can imagine, it's a hot day as it is. Now they're on an animal that's exuding body heat at the same time. So they're really very hot, and they do look as though they're laughing at the best joke that anyone's ever told. Or perhaps the zebra just told a joke, but I think it's probably more likely that they are feeling quite warm. Look, seriously. Wait for it. Oh, here comes the next one. He's still laughing. Here's the other one. Ah, see? The joke's funny again. Every now and again stops thinking about the joke and then remembers it and starts laughing again. The comedians of the bush, much like myself. No, definitely not. Right, we are going to leave the zebra, and the reason we're going to leave the zebra is we've got quite a time-sensitive or movement-sensitive sighting on our hands. Mvula has popped out once again, and this time, Viam, and I think we owe Viam a huge thank you for this, has been working hard on Jigger to hopefully improve our ability to go to places like Sydney's Dam. I don't know what mumbo-jumbo magic he did, but he's done something, and now Jigger's signal is remarkably improved. Bravo to Viam, who's not only a good cameraman, but very talented cameraman, but he's also very clued up about things that I have absolutely no about how they work. No idea about how they work. Viam says don't count your chickens before they hatch yet. We haven't got there yet. Aha! Right, back to the story that I got disrupted by the zebra and the laughing oxpeckers. Right, Karula's daker. Oh, look, he's also told a joke. Oh, perhaps he overheard the oxpeckers. Oh, Karula's kill, daker kill, was up in the jackalberry, and she caught that impala on her way to go and fetch it. I went back to the daker earlier this afternoon. I took the whole crew to go and see Karula and her cubs, and I went to go and check on the daker kill, and there was nothing except one very guilty-looking tawny eagle sitting on the branch. Viam and myself have just gone for a short walk to double-check the area, and the daker is still there, and with only about a 10% of it has been eaten by that bird. And I mean specifically that bird, not that species of bird. I mean that tawny eagle that we're looking at right now. Because as I came round the corner earlier, we interrupted it mid-gulp, and it's taken off and flown to the top of the boerbeen on Vulture's Nest. I've been tracking it the whole time, and I lost track of it, and there it is again. Quite a couple of fluffy patches of white on it. And tawnies come with a lot of different colour variations. In this case, this is probably a juvenile, although you do get morphs with quite a lot of white on them. That joke must have been hilarious. All the birds are laughing. Let's go to Imbula. I'm quite a long way off and I'm terrified he's going to disappear behind the damn wall. Ah, sorry. A stable fly just bit the bottom of my foot and it's really itchy. Rightio. We will come back to Karula, by the way, but there's no visual of her at the moment. An interesting question while we trundle along. Andy says, please, please, please tell him what we get up to in between our two safaris. It depends on the season. So in winter, our days are not too long because obviously we don't have to get up. We get up with the sun, so we usually end up only getting up at about 5:30 in the morning in the middle of winter, which is pretty manageable, and finishing our safaris at around 6. So it's quite a shortish day. So in summer, we get up at about 4:30 or 4:00, and then our days are slightly longer. So sometimes we have a nap, but a lot of the time our time is filled with different things. My time, for example, if we have some possibility of taking the crew out, those of whom that can't get out to go and see the animals every day as we do, I'll take them out on a little bumble to go see lions or leopards. And then Brent and myself will spend a good portion of our day doing research on the different questions that have popped or occurred to us during the day, and just generally trying to supplement our knowledge. Our camera crew do an enormous amount of logging of footage. As I said, VM spent a great deal of yesterday and actually after the drive yesterday evening sorting out amps and all kinds of other mysterious things that I don't understand. Our content crew have all kinds of meetings that they have to do and all kinds of things that go on behind the scenes. So there's lots and lots of work to be done. There's a lot of work that goes into keeping these live safaris running, and it's not just done during the 3-hour morning and 3-hour afternoon safaris. There's a huge amount that goes on. Occasionally we make time to go for a swim in the swimming pool at Inga's house, which we haven't actually done in a very long time. I think we need to repeat that more often. But as we've mentioned before, we're on a bit of a skeleton crew at the moment, so that hasn't happened recently because there just hasn't been time. There's an enormous amount of effort that goes in. And then, of course, what we also do twice a week usually is we have feedback meetings. So essentially, it's an opportunity to see where we can improve our live safaris, how we can make them better for you, what we could have done differently in certain situations. I mean, it's not necessarily just criticism, it's also you did that well, or let's try this next time we start, so those sorts of things. So that's what we get up to on our in-between. The one thing I know I've got to do now, in between our next tomorrow morning and tomorrow afternoon's sunrise and sunset safari, is change all of the new tyres that we've just bought for Wendy and put them on Jigger, because Wendy's died. Having done it all for Wendy, we're going to do it all again for Jigger. So Those sorts of things will keep us busy. Right, we're going to race across to Mbula. While we do, let's head across to Brent, who's found another bird of prey. What's it doing on the ground?
I think it could be eating a baby plover or lapwing on the edge of the Arethusa airstrip. I can't really see too well. Well, this is an interesting looking bird. It's eating the eggs. It's eating plover eggs. Look at that. It's found the plover's nest. It's broken open the eggs. Are we on full? Oh, dear. Can you hear the plovers mournfully wailing close by? If you actually look a little bit to the right, Chandra, it's probably mom just behind the bird of prey. I'm not giving away what bird of prey it is because Jandre said, don't tell me. I want to guess. So would you like to guess with Jandre, which eagle is this that is eating the plover's eggs? There's the crowned lapwing mother. Oh, I can see, look at that. You can just see the eggshells there. Now, if he flies away, I might want to collect those for my collection of things. We might have to get one for James in the tent. So if you know what eagle this is, send your answers through to questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Now, one of the distinguishing features is look at those long legs. How far the feathers extend. I think this could be the first one of the season as well. That's a big clue, Chandra, to what eagle this is. Now you can see it's got very baggy feathers around its legs. It is a true eagle, an Aquila eagle. There's the poor mom and dad. Which the eagle might be about to take off, I think. Oh, there we go. Oh, look at that. Attack now. It's a bit late, lapwings. Isn't this incredible? Oh, there he goes. A bit late. Now, there you go. They could still bomb him again. No. They're going to go check their nest. They might bomb me, though, but I want to go get those eggs or those egg shells. So, now there could still be, there's a couple of lapwings that nest along the edge of this airstrip, but oh, go to the left a little bit. A little bit more. A little bit more to the other two. There. Okay, sorry, I thought I saw a baby in the grass, but it wasn't. So back. Now that's a very tricky eagle, that one we've seen there. So I wonder if we've got some serious birders out there who are going to be able to tell us what it is. And he's still sitting next to the airstrip. Right. Oh dear. That's why I was wondering why it was so quiet. I got so excited I pulled my earpiece out. Okay, I want to try get the... Well done, Safari, Ginny and Joan. It is indeed a steppe eagle. It's migrated from the steppes of Russia, from Chernobyl, can you believe? Also the steppes of Mongolia, and come to summer here in sunny South Africa. Now I want to go see where that nest is, see if we can get any nice pieces of eggshell for the tent. Make James happy, give him something else to look at under the microscope. Now, Musical in Colorado is wondering, why would the lapwings put their nests right out in the open like that? Well, they are ground nesting species. They're actually quite successful. Those are normally very well camouflaged. What I think happened is the eagle saw the mother on the nest, and because quite often they'll stand off away from the nest. They'll use all sorts of tricks to try and lead predators away from nests, pretend they've got broken wings, and then you also saw them, they will try attack much larger predators from time to time as well. Clever steppe eagle. Okay, I'm gonna go wander across there, see if I can find any pieces of those eggs. And we don't drive across airstrips, not a good idea. Might get taken out by an aircraft. Well, we know you don't drive across airstrips while it's light in the bush. Okay, so I think we're going to jump back across on board with Jamie while I go search for those eggshells. I will show them to you once I've found them.
Well, Brent heads off to investigate a very sad scene. Shame. Can't help feeling sorry for the poor things. I'm just listening to the Game Drive channel at the same time, find out what's happening with Mbula. We're trundling along the northern boundary, and it feels like a long time since I've been on Buffalo's cut line properly. This is where we saw those two, speaking of little ground nesting birds and their offspring, this is where we saw the three bronze-winged courser chicks on our explorations that Viam managed to spot. And if you missed them, they were utterly adorable. They were like little bobblehead figures, heads far too big for their bodies. I'd show you a picture in my bird book, but I've lost my bird book. I took it out of the car in case it rained, and I'm not entirely sure where I've put it. I'll have to get one of the other four out of our room, out of our library. Let's see if there's anything happening at Tambuerti Dam. Apparently there are lots of hyenas spread out in Buffalo's Hook. Obviously attracted to the prospect of Mvula's kill, perhaps. I'm thinking some of them might be around mud wallows. I'm just still so desperate to have a chance to see our hyena clan back once more. Since they abandoned us and moved to the Manuleti. I got so excited the other morning when we heard a hyena calling right from the den site. And I went and checked both dens, the Galago and the Mvubu Road den. No luck there. They obviously haven't returned to us just yet. They'll come back, I think, when the Nkuhumas are a little older. The Nkuhuma cubs. Oh, he's on the damn wall. Oh.
cannot hear very ticket, just very close to the dam wall itself.
There's Zebra here, but we're just going to go. Sorry. Just in case he goes over the dam wall, because if he's in the dam wall, he's probably sitting in the sun. Which means he's going to want to move to the shade. Oh, so many zebra. Lots of little foals.
Yeah, I think so. A cougar as well.
So torn. So torn. Look at this gorgeous little foal. Okay. No, let's go. Sorry, little foal, you are gorgeous. But we've got a leopard that we haven't seen in a very, very long time. Ah, of course. All the animals coming out of the woodwork now. There must be about 40 zebra here. All right, guys, I'm just going to go a little bit slowly so that we don't startle these buffalo as we go through. Hi, guys. Another buffalo herd. It's amazing. Seen so many of them recently. Despite the presence of the Nkuhumas. Hello. Okay, sorry. We are going to Mbula. We have a question about how we go about studying this for a career, and I'm sorry, I didn't quite catch the name. TAP RSA, is that correct? And then presumably, I don't know if the RSA, perhaps that means that you are South African. You were saying that you'd love to do this for a career, and do you have to study to do it? Not necessarily a tertiary degree, so you don't have to study to be a guide in the sense that you have to go to university and study it. I, for example, studied law, which is, as you can see, going very well. My legal career has taken off in leaps and bounds. But you do have to, yes, you do have to study. And there are a number of different ways to go about training to do it, and you will have to pass a series of exams that you can set about writing and learning a little bit more about the things. You have to do a national qualification in order to do it, and from there you can progress up steadily in levels, and obviously it's all about the experience as well. Sorry, Impala, I see you. So yes, you do have to study. If you are really keen on learning more about how you can go about doing this, because I really enjoy getting through questions like that, and I really would encourage those of you who would love to do this to go about and do it. If you have the means, if the opportunity is available for you, do it. If you think you'll be passionate about it, I cannot tell you. I don't think there's a single career that is as amazing as this truly is. So yes, absolutely. If you want further details, if you are serious about being keen, you can send through your details to Final Control. Please do that on the email address, rather. You can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. Anything else can be addressed through the hashtag as well. But sending through an email will then be forwarded to me, and I will offer you up a little bit more advice in a situation where I can sit down and discuss it with a bit more time. So if you are really keen, and that applies to any of you out there that would like to make a career of this, let me know and we can chat a little bit more about it. Okay, we're just going to stop here at this herd of buffalo so I can chat on the Game Drive channel before I go racing in, just to make sure we can go in. Shame. Some of the buffalo herds that have come through here have had it worse than others. Oh. Very, very skinny looking individuals. Tax.
Yeah, go ahead.
Do you mind if I try and come and have a look at Mvula from the cut line, see if we can see him?
Behind the dam wall, I don't know, maybe he might come out. I left Henry there, but yeah, it was just a man behind the dam wall. But yeah, you're welcome to come to the boundary, there's no problem. It's also camping out there.
Copy that, thanks very much. Oh, it sounds like he's just ducked behind the dam wall. We were talking about our poor skinny buffalo. The fact that the drought has had a tremendous effect on some of them. Some of them seem to be healthier looking than others. I think perhaps those that managed to get to the northern parts of Kruger that had a little bit more rain than we did over the last rainy season. And even now, with the fresh green grass, not quite fully recovered. And some won't recover at all, particularly the older members and the younger members of the buffalo. Hayley, let's go a little bit further forward, and I think we're going to encounter a whole herd of buffalo at Sydney's dam by the sounds of it. Hayley, you wanted to know how you can tell the difference between a male and a female buffalo. You were wondering if there is any difference in color. In color, no, not so much. Some of the bigger, older bulls tend to be a darker brown, almost black in color, whereas the cows are generally brown, but you've got to be careful with that because you get young bulls that are also brown as well. So I'm going to show you, but hopefully I'm going to be able to show you with a view of the animals themselves. So Hayley, as we're presented with this rear view of the buffalo, and actually this is a perfect example because there's a young bull there. Oh dear, going to be tricky. There is a young bull there, walking second from the back. If you have a look, one of the big ways is the obvious way. Big difference between males and females, if you can have a look at that one passing on the right of your screen, it's got testicles and a penis sheath that sticks out on the belly. And that is absent in the females. Even with lactating females, nipples between the back legs, the testicles are still far more prominent. And Hayley, I'm going to keep answering, but I'm going to try and get to Sydney's dam because obviously these chaps are going into Buffalo's Hook. Hopefully there'll be more buffalo there. One of the other big ways is to have a look at their horns. Now, typically, even that young male hasn't yet got to the point that he's developed it properly. I'm just pulling over for a vehicle as well. So that young bull hasn't quite got to the point of developing his horns properly. But the cows do not have a well-developed boss. In other words, at the base, there he goes, at the base of their horns. And they typically have fur in between the left horn and the right horn. When you look at a male buffalo, the boss, which is such a brilliant name for it, I really think it is, the boss. The boss that sits at the base of the horns is very thick and joined together. Just letting this gentleman know he can come through. Shame that was so polite of him. Hello.
Hi guys.
How's it? Good, thanks. How are you?
Good, yeah.
On your way back in?
Yeah, I just went to the hospital today.
Oh, wonderful. Okay. All right, enjoy. Perfect, thanks. We're going to race down that side. Cheers. I don't know who that was. It's terrible. I recognize his face, can't remember his name. Oh dear. Anyway, so yes, the boss of the male buffalo is far more developed than the female buffalo. So those are the big ways, but as I said, the obvious way, the usual way that you would tell difference between male and female is relatively obvious in buffalo. It's not so obvious, for example, in, let's say, an elephant, where you have to look at other physical differences between them. Here we go. This should make life a lot easier, Hayley. We can talk about this properly with good examples. Hello, buffalo. Okay, I'm trying to go slowly to give our signal a good chance. There we go. So we've got this massive buffalo herd gathering around Sydney's dam. Okay, so then we have quite a young buffalo on the left, which is going to be difficult because if it's a young buffalo, a sub-adult buffalo, you might have to look for the obvious differences as well. So there it's a female because it has a smooth belly. Let's see if we can find an older cow. There we go, that's a full-grown buffalo cow. You can see how it's got tufts of hair on the base of its horns, where the two horns meet in the middle. Tufts of hair, and it's not particularly well-developed. It's got a bump on its belly, but that is from where the umbilical cord attached. So that little bump, that's a tiny little bump. Oh, and a nasty injury on its backside. A couple of welts there. Here comes another adult female. Now let us try and find a bull. There we go. VM's done a good job of finding a bull. It's the one at the back. You can see, look at the horns of the buffalo on the left. Those are all cows. And behind him, now look at the horns of the buffalo at the back with the ox pickers on his back. Oh, he's playing. He's gone shy. There, look there. Okay, so he's got a little bit of hair, but that's because he's quite a young buffalo. You see how much more prominent? Ah, perfect. Female on the left, male on the right. See, this is perfect for our purposes. See how much more developed the bones are around the boss or the base of the buffalo's skull. Very, very clear difference. And then if this female shifts out of the way slightly, then you can see the penis sheath on his belly. Much, much larger than the small hernia bumps or the small belly button bumps that the females have, always with a tuft of hair on the end. Oh, there you go. Difference between a male and a female buffalo. Perfectly demonstrated by the buffalo very kindly standing side by side. Oh, now we've got this little one here. I don't want to actually go drive forward while she's still in front of me. Let's wait for her to rejoin the rest of the herd or to move past us. She's going to be on her own. Now this, look at this. This buffalo's in better condition than the others. Still not great, actually, now that I look at her hip bones. Shame. It's been a very rough ride for these animals. Bulk grazers, in other words, they're not really capable of processing trees and leaves and branches, which has meant there's been no alternative food source for them. They do occasionally browse on leaves, but it hasn't been the easiest time at all. And the other thing is, of course, they're much larger than the other bulk grazer, which is a zebra, for example, which means they've got more weight to sustain. And generally, buffalo need to feed off quite good quality grass. They just haven't had that option while they've been going through this drought and through our dry patch. Okay, everybody, let's give it a go. Let us try at least figure out where Mvula is so that we can try again later. Perhaps he'll go for a drink. Been teetering on this for days at a time. Well, actually, since yesterday. Here's the rest of the buffalo. Coming, streaming down to have a drink. Oh, actually, I think they might have already had their drink and they're splitting off away from the rest of the group. I really enjoy coming to Sydney's Dam and getting those sort of long-distance visuals. I'm going to see if I can try and work out where exactly Mvula is. I'm going to see if I can try and spot Andrew. Maybe we'll get lucky, maybe we won't. We'll just have to keep trying. In the meantime, let's go across and see what Brent's up to on Arethusa.
So we're on the Arethusa airstrip. The wind is howling. We have fortunately taken refuge from the beating African sun in some shade. Now, under normal circumstances, I would just pop this on the dashboard, but the wind's so strong, I'm going to have to just keep my finger on it. There we go. So, you won't believe how long it took us to find that plover's egg. We actually had to play back the footage, and Jandre had to go meter left, right, left, left, right, right, to find it. That's how incredible that camouflage is when it's on the ground. So there were three eggs, unfortunately for the plovers. All three eggs were opened by that eagle. I'm just gonna try it. Oh, the wind. And very, very delicate. So here you can see the inside. Now, it was amazing. Even in that time it took me to find the nest, I'm gonna swap out eggs, Andre, just so you know. A huge amount of ants had already got there, and some of them got stuck in that, I suppose, egg yolk, and they weren't able to get out. Look at that. Oh, there's one dude. So, I mean, that was what, 2 or 3 minutes? There are already about 300 little ants climbing in there, and some of them of course, as you can see, got stuck in that egg yolk. There's one dude there who looks like he's just eating away. Happy ant? Probably not. He could be stuck as well. Or it's his best friend drowning in the yolk in front of him. But isn't that very cool? So, well, I'm just gonna put those very carefully into a safe spot in my bigger case so they don't get broken. And I've got a nice little baggie for them. I think that should work quite well. Theoretically for sunglasses, but it'll work for plover eggs as well. So many little pieces. I want to keep them all. I'm going to give James the smallest piece. Keep the biggest piece for myself. I'm only joking, of course. I'll give James two small pieces. Okay, so what I'm doing, let's just jump on the radio quickly, is I'm waiting for a chance to go see the lions. And as I said, it's quite busy here. So once we've had a look at the Tsalalas, I'm probably going to head back towards Juma, maybe try and see if Karula's still around, or the Nkumas. And there's a lot of vehicles cycling through these sightings at the moment. So what, it was really great. How exciting was it to see Anderson? Roy.
Here we go.
Oh, sorry about that. Roy, can you confirm lineup for Tsalalas, please? Copy, thanks very much. I'll see you there. Yay! So we're not far from them. And I was actually what one calls dawdling. And dawdling worked out quite well for us today because we got to see the first steppe eagle of the season. And actually got to see something I've never seen before. I've never seen a steppe eagle eating a lapwing eggs before. Isn't that absolutely incredible? That's the absolutely amazing thing about, we're alive. We literally do not know whether the Tsalala pride is going to jump on Jandre and take him off the back of the vehicle in the next 10 minutes. I don't think they're going to do that. Jandre seems to have washed his hair recently. Otherwise, it's a strong possibility. Sorry, comms are a bit bad this side. I think it says Love Nita would like to know whether the Tsalalas are in the Nkuhumas territory. And no, they're not. The Nkuhumas, north and west of here, and the Tsalalas, this is part of their territory, from here down to the Sand River. Now, can you believe, I used to see that Tsalala pride was the main pride of lions I used to see in 2005, 2006. In around the Sand River. They're named after a low-felt gardenia tree and a place called Tsalala Pan on Londolozi. Now, Tsalala Pan is a beautiful natural pan where there's quite a lot of low-felt gardenias. And the original tailless lioness, and she's got no tail, therefore her name was the tailless lioness. I know other people called her different things, but I only knew her as tailless. She was one of my favorite lions at the time. And the original tailless and the grandmother or great-grandmother of these little guys here. Now, the amazing thing is her daughter, who is the main lioness here, is also a tailless. Now, there are a couple of lionesses with this pride. So they could be... She might not be here. I know there's a theory that one of them has cubs. So we're just waiting for one. There we go. Just pop in here behind Ryan. Are you happy with that, Jean-Dre? So Ryan's just telling me, when he arrived here, the lions were lying under the marula tree. If we come out a little bit there. Jandre. And now this happens with lions quite often. You see where Ryan's car is. The shade from Ryan's car the lions keep moving closer and closer to lie in the shade. And that's how relaxed they are around these vehicles. Look at that. There we go. The young Salala boys. Sachs would like to know, would the young males fight with the Birminghams? Not at this age. Pat. I don't know, for some reason, with this wind, our communication seems to be a bit iffy at the moment. Now, Pat was wondering, would they fight with the Birminghams? At this age, the Birminghams were in South Africa. There's a wonderful little description called a snortglup. And a snortglup basically means if you hit something so hard, all the snort comes out of them. Now, that's what the Birmingham boys would do to these little boys if they happened to even think about fighting with them. The Birmingham boys are in their prime, and they are well experienced at waging lion warfare, whereas the young Salalas are probably good at beating up their moms and little sisters. Not quite in the same level of the Birmingham boys. I'd say they're probably 2.5 to 3 years old. As I said, we don't spend much time with this pride. We don't see them too often. And so it's... And one of the reasons they're up here at the moment is possibly because the Matimbas are down around the Tsalala Pan area. And the Matimbas would do the same thing to those little boys, even though the Matimba males are quite old. Those young boys are still no match for them just yet. Remember, if you are new and you've just found us, we are sitting next to lions live in the African bush. You can send your questions through to #SafariLive on Twitter or questions@wildearth.tv. Now we're sitting with the Salala pride. And I'm just trying to think. No, it's not the first pride of lions I ever saw in the Sabi Sands. The first pride of lions I ever saw in the Sabi Sands are no longer. They were called the Castleton Pride. They were wiped out by the Mapoho. So the tailless lioness is just lying where we can't see her. I'll try and move a little bit later. For now, we're in the best spot. Oh, head up. Oh, they look reasonably well fed. Apparently they caught a buffalo in Shirley's not that long ago. I just mentioned the reason that Salala Pride is this far to the north, although they traditionally do come up into this area, is because the Matimba males that were pushed by the Birminghams are now to the south. And Drago was wondering that. So the Salalas have been just to the south of us quite a bit, and also to the west, outside of what would be traditionally their range. And the reason for that is those young males. Now, if they didn't have those young males, they would probably accept the Birmingham boys as the latest conquerors of their area. Now, they're still trying to ensure these young males go off to independence, which should happen quite soon. You'll probably find these females are going to start coming to estrus and will start mating with the Matimbas relatively soon. But while these boys are not independent, these lionesses are going to try to keep them as far away from the Birminghams and the Matimbas. I can't remember who's fathered or apparently fathered these ones. Could have been the Majingalans. I'm not 100% sure. Now, if you notice her eyes, she's also got amber eyes. Of course, it's not the amber-eyed in Kahuma. She's a very pretty girl. Now, I've seen, as I said, I was one of the first prides I saw when I was working on Lozi, and they literally used to be in and around our staff village on many an occasion. The one morning, there's a, as you drive into Londolozi before you get to the lodges. There's the boom gate, and there's a man with a clipboard in a little hut, and he gets there at about 7 o'clock every morning. And he's got one of those old stable doors on his little hut. And what he does is, because there are five lodges at Londolozi, is he sits there and he directs you down which road to go depending on which lodge you are going to. And on that particular morning, we came up to the little hut, and the bottom half was closed, the top half was open, and there was a Londolozi camp and two sets of eyes looking over the bottom, trying to reach for the top half of the door to close. And just outside were the original tailless lioness and her two daughters, which are these, I'm pretty sure these two females here, and five mapohos. And Shane, he had just arrived at work, and he said he was just checking his arrivals for the day when the lions wandered up and flopped down in front of his hut. He said he just managed to close the bottom half, but he was scared the movement of closing the top half might attract their attention. Now, we had some interesting stories with those lions around, because they were in camp often. The funniest for me was with the Mapocho males. Now, as I said, Londolozi's got five small camps, or five camps spread out along about 2 kilometers of the Sand River. And there's a central kitchen. And then each of the lodges have their own satellite kitchens. So a lot of the big prep and stuff is done by the head chef in the main kitchen. And then the final, obviously, cooking and stuff is done in the little satellite kitchens at the individual camps. And we were following the late great Mapocho male lions. And what happened was, we came down into the entrance road to one of the lodges, and there came Connie. Connie was a very large lady. She was about my height, so a very tall Shangaan lady, and a very large Shangaan lady. And she was driving off to one of the camps to go deliver the food, and she came around the corner on her golf cart, and she was driving a golf cart, and we were trying to stop her from coming through in our game drive vehicles. And I've never seen it done, and I don't think it can be done to this day. Connie, who was driving the golf cart, drove, stopped, put one leg on the ground, turned the whole golf cart around and sped off in the other direction with the Mapocho coming after it. We managed to drive a game drive vehicle in between the lions and the golf carts. And that was very funny. Connie, from that day on, refused to drive the golf cart after dark. I don't blame her. I wouldn't want to drive a golf cart into a pride of five male lions after dark. So, we will move just now. We'll just wait for Orion to make his way out, and we'll pop around. We'll see if we can see the tailless behind of the tailless female. Now, Paul says he thinks the Tsalala females are much bulkier than the Inkahumas. That's difficult to say, Paul. I mean, they're all quite big lionesses. I mean, an average lioness is anything from 110, 115 kilograms up to 150. And it's so difficult without seeing them next to each other. It's very possible that it could be a bit bulkier. the young males. I can't see him from where I'm sitting. Matt is heads up. Yes, I think the only other person is currently, with the Safari Live team who's seen the Mapocas would be James. Of course, James and I were both at Londolozi over the same time, over 10 years ago. Sure, we're getting old. James faster though. Okay, there we go. We're gonna pop around and move into a different spot shortly. Okay. Let's go see the bottom of the lioness, see if it's tailless. Do I detect the lack of a tail? I do. So there we go. Now, for me, it's very strange. I mean, a tailless lioness is not something you see very often. And to have two tailless lionesses in two consecutive generations, both losing their tails to hyenas, is very strange. So her mother and now her have both lost their tails to hyenas. Her mother had less of that, the stump, than that. It was almost completely flat. It does give her, when she's up and mobile, quite an interesting outline. It doesn't seem to affect her hunting prowess at all. She's still a very successful hunter. Isn't that incredible? Now, I think you were saying, Jamie, and you saw the Salalas not that long ago?
A week ago. About 100 metres over.
A week, yeah?
But they were off to visit.
Ah, yes, I do remember. Well, nice of them to come visit. Let me reminisce about my days on the Sand River. Oh, they look like, oh, there we go. Oh, roll over. Definitely more of a stump than her mother used to have. Okay. So we're still sitting there. Look. And you can see there's still a little bit of an open wound. Not really an open wound, more of a scar tissue buildup. But as long as I've seen this lioness in the northern Sabi sands, she has had a stump. But these boys have grown up incredibly. Now, the last time I remember seeing them was at Sydney's dam, where they went on a buffalo killing rampage. I think it was 4 buffalo in 3 days at Sydney's dam. And the local hyena population also gave them quite a hard time in that area, and sniffing the air, hoping for some buffalo. My comms in. Yes, they are. Is Kirsten talking to me? My comms are in. There we go. They're working now. Yes, I can hear you, Kirsten. Okay, so it looks like we're quite lucky. I thought there would be more pressure, so we can spend a little bit more time here. So we're going to sit patiently here. Yeah? And let's sit this way so you can see a lion behind you. It's not better than just looking at me. What do you think, John? Okay, we're good here? Okay, great. There's a lion behind me, and we're live. No, I'm joking. You guys know all of this stuff. But as I'm saying, it's quite nice to see animals we don't see frequently, like the Anderson male and the tilalas. It's a great part about being in an open system. I mean, if we include the whole Greater Kruger, Mozambique and Zimbabwe, it's 8.5 million acres that is purely dedicated to wildlife, which is incredible. Now, if you think about old world Europe, for example, the largest intact piece of temperate forest in old world Europe is in Poland, and it's less than 20,000 hectares. So what's that, 40,000 acres of actual intact wilderness, pristine wilderness in old world Europe, 40,000 acres. We're sitting in 8.5 million acre. It's outstanding. It's unbelievable. Now, back to our tailless wonder. Mary is wondering whether the loss of a tail affects her balance. Not that I've seen her, and from what I've heard and from watching her mother, she was an incredibly proficient hunter without that tail. And of course, it's always just one thing less for the hyenas to bite. That, of course, was a joke, as she did lose it to hyenas battling over a carcass. Now, they're looking particularly healthy. Now, for me, that middle, or the young male on the left, is the biggest of the three. And see, I'm not sure whether they were all born to a single female or they're from separate females. We'll have a better look. There could be a little bit of age gap between them. I always love young male lions. They sort of look quite awkward. Like they haven't quite grown into themselves yet. I suppose a bit like a gangly teenage boy. Acne and facial fuzz. So guys, I need to be on the game drive radio for a little bit to try and organise the sightings that's coming in. It looks like we will be able to stay a little bit longer with the Tsalala Pride. Okay. So I'm just going to be quite busy for the next little while. And I wonder what Jamie's getting up to back on Juma. So while I just chat away on the radio, and we'll be back shortly, we're going to jump back across to Jamie, who's on Juma.
On Juma and on my way to see whether or not, sorry, I'm trying to not take my eye off the bird I was trying to get on camera, but it flew away. Sorry. on my way back to see if Queen Karula has decided to come back out into the open. At the start of the sunset safari, she was very much in some very dense vegetation. We weren't actually 100% sure exactly where she was. Now that's what we're going to go and do now. But what an exciting afternoon it has been. Two sets of animals, two separate sightings of animals that we hardly ever get to see. I'm sorry about Mvula though. We did try. I actually went all the way around to Gowrie Gate to try and see if we could get a view down there and got some very odd looks from the gate people who I think thought I was trying to put them on camera secretly, which I wasn't. I was just trying to see the leopard. But we tried. We tried our best and it didn't work out. Now let's go see what else we can find. I haven't driven down Aubrey's Road in a very long time. And judging by the vehicle tracks, nobody else has either. And we might actually even encounter tracks for Tingana, who I suspect... We don't know. We never found any tracks of him crossing out of Juma. Tingana, by the way, for our newer viewers, is the dominant male leopard of this area. So he's the sort of Anderson equivalent of Juma. Not quite as big, but nearly. He came onto the property a couple of days ago. We heard him sawing his way past the DRC, which is the main camp that everybody lives in. Not the Democratic Republic of Congo, the Juma research camp. See if I can get this bird on camera at least. It's calling off in the distance. Where are you? I can hear an oriole. I just can't see it. It's whistling. It's taunting me. But yes, I suspect that... Gotcha. Okay, it's quite far away. It's a bit further than I thought. It's on the top left-hand point of that... marula tree that hasn't yet got its leaves at the back. Little bit down and to the left. Gotcha. There we go. A black-headed oriole that's been chirping away at me. That look really odd. A bit like it's lost a little bit of feathers around its head. Huh. Beautiful whistling call. Whenever I see those birds, I always think of Sam, who was a previous presenter with Wild Earth, and they were one of his favorite birds. And I know when he got back to this area, he was so excited to see them, because he hadn't seen them in such a long time. So I will forever, ever think of Sam whenever I see a black-headed oriole or a squirrel. If I see squirrels, I also think of Sam and his positive squirrel. Very good question, I suppose, for somebody who doesn't know the area. I'm sorry, I threw that term out like you were just expected to know. So a very good question from Dispatch Griffin, who would like to know what exactly the Gowrie Gate is. The Gowrie Gate is the main entrance to the northern Sabi Sands. So it sits, you can imagine it, I'm not going to draw you a map because I do want to get to see if Karula's around. So it sits right up in the top northwestern corner, if this is north, northwestern corner. Juma is sort of here. Buffalo's Hook is sort of here. Manyaleti is here. And Simbambili and Arethusa are there. So it's the road at the end of Triple M, on the northern end of Triple M Road. That's the boundary between Arethusa and Juma. And the main entrance point for all staff and private personnel. I'm not sure if you could hear what we have just said. I think the Sabi Sand equivalent to the gates of Mordor. I don't think it's quite that bad just yet, VM. But getting in can be roughly the equivalent to getting Zauron to let you in. This is a bizarre train of thought you've led me down, VM. Very strange. Stop and have a look at something quickly. Ah, oh, it's a bachelor herd. I want to find you a ewe, an impala ewe. Hold on one moment. They're really starting to show clearly. Of course, this would be the one impala herd that is still a bachelor herd. Now that I wanted to show you something first. There we go. There's a lady. Now she's wandering off. Their pregnancies are really starting to show. Some of the ewes are looking so heavy. Now, they've still got another, what month are we in? October, middle of October. They've still got another month and a half before they get to relieve themselves of that burden. That's something to really look forward to. This time last year, I remember sitting with an impala ewe and actually seeing the fetus kick, which is a truly, I don't know, it's an amazing moment to see that movement. Here we go. This might be a little easier to see. I think it's still a bit early. Oh, Mr. Ram. The male impala startled and scared them all. The males have been chasing them round and round and round and round over the last few days. I don't know why. I think they've just got their wires crossed in terms of when mating season actually is. They should only really be chasing females in June. Sorry guys, I'm just listening to the Game Drive channel. Heard something about Karula. Ephraim, I'd like to make my way towards Karula. Are there any other stations on standby? Copy that, thanks. I know Andrew did see one a little bit further south. If you keep following the Mulwati south, there's a big jackalberry up on your right hand side if you're going south, and you should see one of them up there.
Okay, copy.
Ah, wildebeest. Let's go catch up with our wildebeest herd as well. It's actually really nice driving around this afternoon. We've had so many incredible sightings recently that we haven't actually been moving around Juma as often as we usually do. And it's nice to just drive around and remind ourselves what's out there. Like this herd of wildebeest. Can you believe how big these babies have got? Hard to believe that these are the same little ones that were stumbling to their feet during wildebeest calving season around December, beginning of January. It was the most incredible sightings that we had with them. I wonder if this is our wildebeest herd. When we last saw them properly, when we could still sort of identify them as our wildebeest herd, we had 10 baby wildebeest. Let's see if they start crossing the road now. Let's see how many we've got. One's already crossed, so we can tick one off. That was one. Here come. Okay. Two. And three. Hello. Four, five, six. This might be a different wildebeest herd. Seven. Eight. Nine. Ten. And with an 11th calling somewhere in the background. Perhaps I counted wrong. Could this be the same wildebeest herd? Listen to the noises they're making. I don't understand what that was about. Oh, now we're all going back that way. Mara Triangle the sequel. What on earth? I have no idea what that is all about. Here comes the mail. Debra, armchair traveller, I do as well. I'm just very bemused by what was that was all about. One of the youngsters called and just kept calling and calling, then decided to go back that way, and then they all ran that way. I don't know, I mean, it's just herding instinct. That was so strange. They do make amazing sounds, though. I really love wildebeest. I find them, first of all, I find them fascinating, and secondly, I find them highly entertaining. I think there's something in their faces. They're gone now. They're all gone. Huh. Well, at least we got to see them. And of course, eagerly anticipate this year's youngsters. We got to see one very, very newborn calf wildebeest calf, in other words, with Brent during last year's calving season. And this poor thing stumbled too close to a herd of Dugger boys and was then promptly shown just how brutal nature can be out here in its first few minutes of life by being thoroughly tossed up and tossed down again by one of the buffalo bulls. Buffalo bulls are not known for their tolerance or their patience. And then we got to, shortly afterwards, see a live wildebeest birth from the minute that the female's water broke in front of me on quarantine, to the moment that her little calf was tottering about on wobbly legs and then suckling from her. A really, truly special experience. And I know that it's something that's actually happened a few times. VM's nickname, wildebeest, comes from, you were the first to record a live wildebeest birth. Now that's really something for us to be looking forward to in the future. Of course, the outcome of my live wildebeest birth was the next morning the Styx Pride came and ate three of them, including, I think, the one that we saw being born, which was also quite tragic. It just goes to show life can be incredibly tough and incredibly short and brutal out here. But let's move on to happier things, like the fact that we've stumbled upon a herd of elephant. Hello, elephants. They've also been wallowing in the mud. I doubt it's the same herd we saw earlier. Oh, there's a little one. Let's go forward a little bit. Could it be Benjamin? I don't think so. I think we've got to be careful of identifying every baby elephant as Benjamin. Here we go. No, definitely not Benjamin. Definitely doesn't have a wrinkly enough forehead, but still adorable. Plucking away at the sickle bush leaves. There's another little one as well. And the whole herd moving about there. Cute. Doesn't matter how many times you sit with them for ages, a baby elephant is still a fascinating thing to watch. Trunk looping and twisting around like a toddler trying to use its hands. Little pink tongue. Musical in Colorado, we've seen, of course, the elephants throwing mud across themselves, but a good question coming through from you, because an elephant naturally will use its trunk to reach down, slurp up water, and then transfer that water from its trunk to its mouth. They never have to put their mouths directly in the water. Hello, Impala. Yes, you're also handsome. Musical in Colorado. I'd like to know how elephants prevent water from getting into their lungs. Do they have a blocking mechanism at the top of their trunk? I don't think so, but I don't know for absolute certain. My suspicion is that it's kind of like if you were sucking up something through a straw, you can control it. You know how you can control how much you take in, and then if you stop the suction, then you can actually hold that in the straw, hold the liquid that you've drawn up into the straw. And I imagine it's the same thing with an elephant's trunk. So they don't breathe and drink necessarily at the same time. although they can still, of course, breathe through their mouths. I think the only thing that they would have that would block the water from going into their lungs would be a... what do you call that thing that we have between our esophagus and our trachea? Epiglottis, thank you very much. I had a brief lack of brain moment there. And again, we're a brief moment of forgetfulness, let's put it that way. Yes, I think that's the only thing that they have. I imagine an elephant's epiglottis is absolutely enormous. I've actually never pictured an elephant's epiglottis before, but I'd be fascinated to know what it looks like. It must be absolutely massive. But I think that's the only thing that they have to stop the... oh, cute. I've got an itchy knee. Itchy wrist, I should be more specific there. Oh, now the other one. And arabesque and down. No, that's not going to be very yummy, I don't think, little one. I suppose investigating it is worthwhile. Maybe there's a bit of bark there. Life's tough when you're trying to learn to use your trunk. When in doubt, just bite it. Get down on your knees and your wrists and bite it off. Especially when you realize you're getting left behind. Okay, little one. Tossing branches over to get to the grasses underneath. Our curious one, I'm going to go forward a little bit so that we know we can see the whole elephant and not just half of it. Curious one, that's amazing. Curious one says that there was a tiny, tiny baby elephant calf on the Juma Dam camera today that looked only about a day old. That sounds amazing. I hope we can find it on our way towards Karula. That would be really, truly lovely. I think I'm going to keep going unless we come across the one-day-old calf, because that is also something truly special to behold when they're still all pink and wobbly and shaky on their legs and furry. The little elephant calves are so, so furry. I think we're going to keep going towards Karula. It's going to start to get dark. We don't have infrared lights on Jigger. I think that might be a good idea to start getting ourselves going. Not that I don't love spending time with the elephants. I'm also a little bit concerned that Karula's going to up and leave us. Hopefully she goes to investigate that daker, because as long as she checks the bottom of that jackalberry tree, she'll find it. It's not where she left it, but it's very, very close. I'm hoping that's what she's going to do, and that will just prolong the period of time that we are able to spend with her, because she's spending a lot of time south of our boundary. And also, it would mean that, you know, she's got an extra meal, that she doesn't actually have to go out and hunt again. And with two growing little cubs, she needs all the help. Well, not help she can get. She needs all the food that she can get. The other amazing thing is, or just interesting, it's an observation. Sorry, Impala. Is that if our hyena den had been... if our hyenas had still been denning on Juma, there's no way Karula would have kept her impala kill last night. She didn't hoist it. It was on the ground. When our hyena den was still around, our hyenas were patrolling that Mwati drainage the entire time. And I think the fact that it was an adult male impala made it very, very difficult. Not a light antelope. Here we go, some more pregnant ewes. with their black stripes across the bottom and on the tail. Okay. Nope. Stop getting distracted, Jamie, and let's go back to Garuda. Now, the reason I'm not going back to the Nkuhumas, although we can try it towards the end of drive, perhaps when Brent gets back he might give it a go. The reason I'm not is because this morning when I took the rest of the crew to go and see them, they were in some seriously almost impenetrable vegetation. And I imagine with the day being as hot as it has been today, I have been listening to the game drive comms as well. Andrew tried to go looking for them. He says they're deep in that Tambuati thicket. We're not going to have a very good view of them at all. But as it starts to get cooler, keep an eye on the dam camera because they might decide. There is water close to where they are, but it's very muddy. It's like the muddy wallows that the elephants were in this afternoon. So keep an eye on the Juma dam camera. They might pop out. Who knows? Lots of buffalo around as well. No, because the game drive comms are mixed up. I mean, the FC comms are mixed up. Or something. I don't know. Something's gone confusingly wrong. All right. So while we skirt on past these more impala to go to Karula, let's head across to Brent for an update.
So we've, there's hair everywhere today, the wind is strong. Maybe I should do the backwards cap. How's that? Styling. Okay, I'm styling today. This is very much outside of what I would normally do. I don't mind wearing leopard print, but wearing my cap backwards, that's pushing the limits a bit far. But we shall try. And we shall see some warthogs. Hello, water pigs. Well, one water pig, the others have departed into the Gwarri thickets. And we have a female warthog on her knees to get to that good grass. Now it's amazing, on the edge of airstrip you often have feeding on this green grass. Now it's from the dew because there's no trees around. Standing by. FM, what's the lineup like? Copy, thanks. I'd like to take first number. Now, oh, you heard me on the radio. What could I have been talking about? Well, there's definitely a warthog where we're going. Biggest male leopard in the zombie's hands. But we're not quite there yet. We're still on first standby. Jandre is literally doing a dance for joy behind me. So we are going into looping mode again. And while I think about looping, oh, what a wonderful pair of steenbokkels. Oh, there were a wonderful pair of steenbokkels till I mentioned them. Now they are disappearing buckles. Now remember, we are live from the middle of the African bush. It has been a really good week of sighting so far. And it's only Tuesday. Is it Tuesday or Wednesday? Thursday. It's not Monday. It's Tuesday. Okay, so it has been incredible, and it seems like it's only going to get better. No, I feel too ridiculous with a cap on backwards. I can't do it. It's enough now. I'm not a hipster. Well, a big welcome to Ellie and Trinity, who are being homeschooled in the Midwest of the USA. Now, I feel like I'm a teacher now. No, but no school in their right mind would probably let me near any children. I'll teach them lots of bad habits, like how to put drawing pins on teachers' chairs. But, carrying on, Ellie and Trinity would like to know if the rainy season's arrived and do we get big thunderstorms and hurricanes like they do. Now, we don't get hurricanes or tornadoes here. We do get very big thunderstorms. Now, we're a little bit early. We did have some early rain, and that's this lovely greenery you're seeing on the ground in front of us, but very little, only about 30 mils. I'm not sure what that is in inches. Much less than an inch. Probably 30 mils, an inch. I think your maths is somewhat. Anyway, well, let's see. Who can tell me how much 30 milliliters is in inches? No, okay, well, someone out there saves us from embarrassing ourselves with our mathematic, Andre is convinced, he's still shouting numbers at me, but I'm not listening to him. But so anyway, yes, so the rainy season normally starts from the end of November. I'm sorry, now, Jandre, stop it. From the end of October, the beginning of November, and it... I nearly got lost, no, I'm joking. And it runs through to sort of May sometimes. Normally ends in March. And we normally get around 350 millilitres, how many inches is that, in a year? 350 to 400. We are experiencing one of the driest periods, actually the driest period ever recorded in the country. And that is, we only got about 160 mils over the whole of last year when we normally have 350 to 400. And we're gonna hopefully find out from someone who, Jandre says it's 14 inches, 350 mils. Then how on earth could 30 be one? Anyway, 0.3 of an inch is 30 millimeters. I knew I was right there somewhere. So, yes, inches big. That's a lot of rain. 12 inches, yes, but 12 inches of rain is like what Gabon gets. Anyway, okay, we're gonna finish this as a silly argument. I'll work it out on an app just now. We're gonna start, as I said, looping around. I think we're gonna get some magic Anderson time. But back to your question. So the rain starts in November and normally go through and goes to sort of March, May. And as I said, 350 mils, and hopefully we're gonna get that this year. So if we have just a nice normal rain, I'm very excited and the grass will come, but already our summer is starting to explode. Our migratory birds, we saw that steppe eagle that's migrated all the way from Russia, from Chernobyl, to visit us for the summer months. Now, a lot of those bigger willy eagles are actually coming for that. The flying ants, and such a massive source of protein that it brings masses of birds from all over the world and Africa down here to feed. Okay, exciting times. I can't see that far, John. That is, there we go. 137 inches is 350 mils of rain. So that's how much we get in a year. Yeah. Sorry, I just need to be on the game drive. Copy that, thanks. I'm on Arethusa Shirley's boundary heading west. I should be there in about 2 to 3. Okay, I'm going to start speeding towards the Anderson Mail. While I do that, let's go to Jamie and see how her search for Karula is going.
I've got to the right area. Now it's just a question. Sorry, I heard something. I was just wondering if perhaps it's not alarm calls at her moving away. I've got to the spot that Karula was in. Now it's just a question of whether or not she is in fact here. Let's go and investigate, shall we? She was here earlier. She might be thinking about moving back towards that Dacre kill. Go nice and slowly. Nothing can be better at hiding than the leopard when it wants to. Doesn't look like she is where we left her. Carcass is there. So where, oh where, is Karula? She could be just here. I mean, she really could. That's all that's left of the impala carcass. That's why I stopped for those, what I thought was alarm calls. I was checking to see if she's not in one of the trees. She's not up in the jackalberry, and I don't think her cub, any of her cubs are either. Alarm calls. Just taking my earpiece out for a sec. Hear the guinea fowl. It sounds like leopard. Oh, that sounds like very frightened guinea fowl. Let's just go investigate a little bit up Mumba Road. I think she's going back to that Dacre kill. In fact, I wonder if we shouldn't go and wait for there. It's a gamble. She might have gone south. As VM said, there are elephant tracks here, which means she might have been chased. That's also a distinct possibility. Don't think she's here. She could be. She could just be over the top of the mound. But those guinea fowl alarm calling, I think I heard a monkey as well when I stopped earlier. And I think all the evidence points to, I know what she's going to do. She's going to go have a drink. I think she's going to do. I don't know. I think she's going to go have a drink at that puddle on Batalia Road. And then she's going to go to the Dacre carcass to investigate. Let's try and get there quite quickly. Now, to Mulwati or not to Mulwati? I think we're Mulwati. We might catch her along the way. She might even have decided to walk along here. Yep. Looks like little leopard tracks going this way. It's all being stepped on by elephants there. But I'm relatively certain I saw leopard tracks going along here. I'm going quite fast because I want to catch her as she gets to the carcass, if she goes to investigate. And I want to see if the cubs are with her as well. Hello, mister. Sorry, I know we've got a lovely giraffe here, but we've got to go quickly. Those alarm calls are still quite far away. Please. Sorry, boy. Here we go. He's relaxed again. And the go-away birds are calling as well. She's somewhere here. I hope this is a gamble that turns out to be correct. Go away, bird's gone. I just stopped to look at which direction it's looking in. She should remember that she's got that Dacre kill. Or did the Impala put it right out of her mind? Everybody, keep your eyes peeled. That flick of the white tail will give her away. Okay, we'll be able to see. I just want to check this pan just up here to see if she's come for a drink. I'm hoping this gamble's Corey busted.
That might be 2002.
2002 was the last time Ephraim saw. Sure. Corey busted. That they last saw in 2002. That's the discussion that Tax and Ephraim are having. A Corey busted is the largest, the heaviest flying bird. Got her. Oh, got a barbet. Oh, wow, look at that. Oh, making little barbets. Huh. That's the first time I've ever seen that, I think. Crested barbets. Sorry to interrupt you. Have you by any chance seen a leopard, or did you have other things on your minds? We've seen the crested barbets building their nests recently. It's nice to see that they are planning on filling them relatively soon. A bird mating tends to be quite a perfunctory act, in just that they don't have genitals in the same way mammals do. They have genital openings known as cloacas, that they just have to touch together ever so briefly for the sperm to be transferred. And now the female has to go about producing her young in an egg. She seems to be frantically cleaning her beak after that experience. I just had a funny feeling that Karula's going to pop out here. There's a water hole just in front of me. Let's just go see that she's not on her way here. I'm going to do some scouring for our... Sorry, I don't know what that was. I didn't quite hear that. Oh, it's gone silent. We've gone silent. Okay, we need to sort things out. We're going to send you across to Brent and we'll catch up with you shortly.
Being so spoiled today, we're back with Lee Anderson. Oh, actually, there's a couple of other guys here, and they said, I don't know why he's called Anderson, and there must be a story behind it. And we'll try and find out a bit more about it. He's back on that warthog carcass. Hopefully he might hoist it, you never know. Yes, look at that. Looking up. Take it up the tree, Mr. Anderson. We would like to watch that very much. Oh, he's beautiful. I'm just going to ask, Tristan, do you know why he is called Anderson? Now, Steph is asking if we... Oh, wait, Jonda, he's going to... Get ready. There we go, he's going to go up. Look how strong he is. Now that is incredible feet. That probably still weighs a good 100 pounds of warthog flesh there. So he's looking for the best route up. Look how he's just peering up. Let's hope he's more successful than Krula was this morning. Here we go. And that is heavy. That is a big warthog. Oh, it almost looks like it's alive for a second, sitting like that. Keeps looking up the tree. He knows the sun is setting and there are a good population of hyenas around here. He wants to get that carcass up and safe. Now have a look. It's a big female warthog. There we go, wait. Steph, I haven't forgotten about you. I'm just really excited for him to lift this up the tree. So while he decides he might need to eat a kilogram of more meat before he takes it up the tree, Steph is wondering, whereabouts are we? I said, yeah, he's going to eat a bit more. Bring that weight down a bit. Steph was wondering exactly where we were in Arethusa. We are quite far west. We're just to the east of the Elephant Plains boundary on a road called Central. I'm just going to move into a different spot quickly. Tristan let me know why Anderson is called Anderson. Now it seems a silly name for a leopard, but we've got a leopard called Quarantine. So it's the name of a little dry riverbed in Malamala. So obviously, like Quarantine, when he became independent from his mother, he spent a lot of time in that area. And that's why he would have got that name exactly the same as the Quarantine male. You happy, Jandre? Happy. Jandre's nodding his head furiously. So, I can't help myself but take a few pictures of this massive beast. I know this is possibly, for a lot of you, the first time you've ever seen this leopard. So remember, share your screenshots on our Facebook page, hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. We'd love to see them. And remember, there's also all the different fan groups created by you where you can share your experiences on the Safari Live journey with everyone out there. And he's still trying to eat a bit more. We saw he tried to hoist it. It's probably just that little bit too heavy still. And the problem with an animal like a warthog is you'll find that he's quite capable of lifting the weight. It's just where the weight is balanced. There he is, looking up. I love it when leopards do that, when they raise their eyes to the sky. Now he's going to want to get that up the tree. The salalas are not far from here, only I'd say probably about 900 meters. And to the east of us is where those lions were. Now I know you guys must be just enjoying soaking up being in the presence of Mr. Anderson, just like Gendre and I are. The sun is setting, so if he doesn't hoist that, we won't stay here after dark. We're sitting here with the Anderson male, the biggest, baddest leopard in the northern Sabi Sands. Let's go to Jamie, who's got the queen of the northern Sabi Sands.
And what perfect timing, and I do have to whisper because Karula is quite close to us. What perfect timing for your arrival with the queen. We have indeed managed to find her, and she's calling. Or she was. Calling for her cubs. Oh, now at 8 months old. Old, her little cubs are showing the serious signs of independence. She's calling again. And we noticed that with the young male this morning while we waited where we went to go and take the rest of the crew. Which does mean that on occasion they spread quite far and wide. And she has to work hard to find them again, or at least call repeatedly, like a mom desperately calling upstairs to recalcitrant teenagers. One in South Africa, speaking of Karula, you wanted to know when will she start mating again. Probably only in about a year. When the cubs are 18 months old, or just over 18 months old, is when she should start mating again, preferably for the survival of the cubs, preferably only when they're about 2 years old would be ideal, but it'll probably be closer to when they are 18 months of age. And then since they're 8 months old now, that is in another 10 months time actually, so not a full year, 10 months. Where are your babies? I know where one was. He moved off quite far away from Karula this morning. Turtle doves, or the ring-necked doves, are making such a noise, it's amazing if those cubs can actually hear over the sound of them. I love that sound. trying to keep my voice down as much as possible so that her cubs can also hear their mum calling. Selena, wondering, I've obviously been with the Anderson male. She's calling them, but she's too round to move. Sorry, Selena. You're wondering if male leopards kill cubs like male lions do. Yes, they do. If a male comes into a territory, he will, and it's a new territory to him, he will kill all of the leopard cubs he finds. The same applies to nomadic males, young dispersal males, and older dispersal males. They will instinctively kill cubs of females that they haven't mated with. But generally, it's in those rare situations where a dispersal male has stumbled upon them. So Tingana, for example, would not be a threat to Karula's cubs since he has mated with her and could be the father. Same way Anderson was not a threat to Shadow's cubs since she had been seen mating with him. Come on, little cubs. Out you come. Sitting and waiting. Okay, while we wait for the cubs to pop out, let's go over to Anderson, see if he manages to get it up the tree.
Looks like he's getting ready again to try hoist that warthog up the tree. I think he's going to succeed this time. What do you think, Chandra?
Yep.
Eat a little bit more again. Oh, we really thought he was gonna go for it there. All he did was turn his back to us. Isn't this exciting? The Anderson male. For the third time ever. Twice in one day, Chandra. Chandra is very happy. So am I. Shannon in Ohio is wondering whether he'll be able to smell the Talala pride. Probably not from this distance, and there's sort of bustling wind. He maybe got a whiff or two of them, but I don't think he would have been able to smell them completely. Come on, big boy. Take it up the tree. He's thinking about it. God, as it gets darker, the chances of him losing this carcass to another predator become higher and higher. There we go. Look at that. Look at that incredible strength. Oh, he nearly fell over. Look how high he's taken it. Absolutely incredible. Wow. Wow, 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 wow. I'll give you an idea. What's left of that warthog carcass probably still weighs more than Karula. And he just straight up the tree with it. I'm going to have a celebratory sip of hot water. Okay, we're gonna have to move now, but there's other people waiting. If you would like to make your way, I can make space for you. So, wow, wasn't that incredible? Okay, isn't that incredible? So, speaking of another incredible leopard, I'm sure he's going to be here tomorrow, but let's go back to Queen Karula. Oh, apparently we're not leaving right yet. You're still with us. Jamie found a gremlin. I'm just going to move to the other side of the tree and get as much of this last couple of minutes as we can before the next vehicle makes the way in. Wow, wasn't that amazing? So exciting. That is incredible. I mean, that is a massive feat, being able to lift that weight into the tree. Tell me when, Andre. Watch yourself there. How's that? Look at that. Would you like some light, Andre? It's a bit too high. Huh? So as I said, okay, we're going to enjoy as much as we can for now, and then we're going to have to make our space. Look at that, isn't he just incredible? He took it right to the top of that marula tree. I would say he's 8 to 10 meters off the ground, and he carried 100 pounds of dead weight up there. So about 50% of his body weight he just carried up a vertical tree for 8 meters, 9 meters. What's that in feet? I don't know. 20 foot, 22 foot more. 30-something, according to Jandre. I believe Jandre. He studied to be a doctor, so he must be good at maths. Beautiful. That's a funny licking motion he's got going there. Now, as beautiful as he's not quite the most suave leopard. I mean, we saw him have a spit yo-yo earlier on the drive, and then that very strange sideways licking motion. So he's not even feeding now, he's just got that carcass up into a position of safety as the sun is setting. Very good, thanks. Deb in Ohio says her friends could not understand her excitement of Anderson hoisting that warthog. Well, don't worry, Deb. All of us understand the excitement and share it with you. Absolutely. I was going to say a naughty word. Absolutely something marvellous, to quote an old British sitcom. Absolutely marvellous. At Here comes that funny lick again. He's a funny looking chap, isn't he? A very strange licking motion he's got going there. Not the most dignified. He looks a bit like a gangster. He's the gangster leopard of the Sabi Sands. He is a very, very exquisite specimen, though. Okay, we're going to make space for Harley to come around here to where there's a nice spot. We're going to have to move on. And Jamie seems to have found some signal. So while we do that, say goodbye to Mr. Anderson and hopefully he'll be here bright and early tomorrow morning. Let's go back to Jamie.
Cooler's now right next to us, still calling. Sorry about that, everybody. We lost signal right at the crucial moment. She's now calling much louder. Looking for her two cubs who've been naughty and have wandered off away from Mum. Here comes one. Here comes a cub. I see you, you little thing. Come on.
Well, it seems like Jamie's found some gremlins. Now, we are just leaving Mr. Anderson. And what an exquisite experience that was to see that incredible power of a massive male leopard lift that dead weight up into a tree. And we're going to start. I'm just so happy right now. I'm just on such a high. I can see Jean-Rez on a high, Deb in Ohio's on a high. And I'm sure there's lots of you out there also on a high. What a wonderful, wonderful experience. This is the first time I've actually spent quality time with the Anderson male. The only other time before today that I've seen him, it was very brief on the boundary of Elephant Plains. And he got up and he walked off goodbye into Elephant Plains. What a splendid evening. I'm so happy, so very happy. Remember, this is 100% live, so you witnessed that live. And remember, if you want to share any feelings about watching that male leopard go up the tree, please do so, hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Actually, I've got a better idea. We'll play the one word game. So tell me, in one word, what word comes to mind for you watching the Anderson male take the warthog up the tree? You can do that by using the hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. One word to describe the Anderson male lifting the warthog. And unfortunately, it seems like I'm losing my comms again. I don't know why. Jandre, did you hear that? Okay, we've actually got a slow-mo of him going up the tree. So I don't know, are we ready to play at final control? Okay, so while we carry on driving, so they're gonna play a slow-mo of the Anderson going up the tree. Remember, one word to describe the Anderson ascending that tree with the warthog. Hashtag Safari Live, questions at wildearth.tv. Wasn't that amazing? So I'm gonna start make my way towards back towards Juma. And it seems like Jamie's found some signal again, so let's go back to her.
Sorry about that, everybody, but as you can see, a happy reunion with one of the little cubs. Karula still calling and searching for the second. Now, this isn't anything to be concerned about. The cubs are roaming further and further afield as they get older, showing more and more signs of independence. And Karula probably has to do this on a regular basis. Sit and call and call and call and call before her cubs decide to return back to her once again. But what a beautiful image that we have here. Mum and I think daughter. It is particularly dark. It's darker than it looks on the camera. It's very dark for me. I can't quite see exactly which one we have here. But a beautiful portrait of Mum and little cub reunited once again. Now, where's the second one? Both panting heavily in the muggy evening heat with full bellies of impala. I'm just keeping my eyes peeled for cub number two to come back and join in. Unfortunately, it is getting very dark for us. We won't be spotlighting Karula's cubs, so we might just have to come back again tomorrow morning in the hope that they are still around. As you can see, it is getting very dark. Our cameras won't be able to cope for too much longer. But at least we've seen the reunion with one gorgeous little cub. Having a thorough cleaning from Mum, and perhaps a scolding as well for ignoring her for so long. Headbutt. Still hoping we're going to get to see the other cub, but unfortunately the light is getting dimmer by the moment. They're also now very much blocking our route out of here. We might have to go all the way down the Mulwati in reverse. Oh, big yawn. But that's okay. Entirely worth it to spend moments like this. My eyes are straining in the dark to try and look around me. I keep thinking I'm seeing flashes of movement, but I'm not. You can see Karula's still aware that she is missing one of two. Looking around intently, she stopped calling for now. But she will presumably resume again in a moment. Heavy, heavy panting.
Getting mobile after 90 changes.
And Shane, you wanted to know what the leopard count was for today. Well, today in total, we had Karula, no two cubs, that's three, plus Tundi, that's four, plus Anderson, that's five. Unless I'm very much mistaken. This afternoon, it's been three, because I don't think we can count a leopard cub that we haven't seen, even if we know that it's here somewhere. Is that right? Have I missed any out? In the last 2 days, we didn't manage to break our record, which is what we were aiming for on the sunrise safari, and just because quarantine had moved south into Mala Mala by the time Brent got to Cheetah Plains this morning. We were aiming for six, which actually, if Tundi's cubs had been there, we would have skyrocketed past the record of five in one drive. And if we'd had a Mvula, we would have managed as well. Okay, I think that's probably it for our sighting. I can barely see them. You can see the camera is starting to get a little stuttery in the darkness, and I can't switch on any lights to help with that. Oh, Karula's up. I think that while we move out, we're probably going to lose signal again. Let's head back over to Brent and see what he's up to.
Well, we're just basking in the wonderfulness of this sunset safari. It's still a little bit too light for us to chuck the spotlight on, see if there are any nocturnal creatures, but we are moving slowly back towards Juma. And Jandre and I were reminiscing about the Anderson's hoist. There we go, we've got some one-worders in. Gail says, great. And Leslie says, brute. I like that, Leslie, that's a good one. Jandre, what's your one word? Woo! There we go, Jandre is woo! What is my one word? Anne, powerful. Bethany, stunning. I'm trying to think of my, my one word is a combination of two words. Fan, something-tastic. Again, quoting, I don't know why I'm quoting old British sitcoms today. I didn't quite hear that. Willow, who's 4 years old, has got a great word. I'm just trying to hear it. Well, Willow, you win the one word competition. I don't care what's coming next. Willow wins with the word boink-a-doodle-doo. Well done, Willow. I think that's fantastic. So we're going to have to get Jandre every time he sees a leopard hoist, he's going to have to go boink-a-doodle-doo. Definitely. Here we go. Just bypassing. Hello, hello.
Good
day. Been nice?
Been good.
Enjoy? Yes. Hi, guys.
How are you doing?
Very well. Oh, so nice. Second time ever. Yes, very excited about seeing Anderson. Cheers, guys. Yeah. Now, Darby's the one who told me about Anderson today. So today, oh no. I've got a friend, and I got a car behind me. Let's try to lose my friend quickly. We lost it. We'll lose it around the corner. So I was at the head rangers meeting today, and every 3 months, all the senior guides from the different lodges, we all get together to discuss certain things. I can't deal with my friend. One of those things I just struggle with immensely. Branch stuck under the car. There it is, naughty branch. Some news from that. It's just been such a fun-filled safari. I haven't had a chance to catch you guys up. I'm afraid I'm going to need to look at something to give you the news. Okay, so. It looks like in Kanyeni's female cub, we don't think she's dead, she's just peeled off from her mother already, and that's a little young, but she might appear again, but she hasn't been seen in a while by anyone. But in Kanyeni's male cub, I'm trying to find his name now. There we go. Kanyeni's male cub has been named. It is Vutomi. Now, there's quite a nice story to Vutomi, especially for the long-term Safari Live viewers. Now, when I first started driving around on that Safari Live, I used to get a lot of questions from a young lady named Shanae in New Zealand. Now, Shanae in New Zealand used to ask some very complicated questions about guiding and etc. And her dream was to become a field guide. Shanae is now a field guide in the Northern Sabi Sands, and she works at Nkoro, which is at the end of this road. And so what happened was that male cub disappeared for quite a while. No one saw him. He was always assumed to be dead. Then when Shanae and her tracker first saw it, Shanae burst into tears and said, he's alive, he's alive. A bit like Dr. Frankenstein, I assume. I'm only joking, Shanae, if you see this. But of course, she was so excited that leopard cub was alive. It was her favorite. It was her first leopard cub since she'd been guiding. And she asked her tracker, Chris, what does alive mean? What is the word for alive in Shangaan? And it is Vutomi. So there we go. That is Nkanyeni's male cub. We can stop calling him Nkanyeni's male cub. We can now call him Vutomi. So there we go. That's some news from the head rangers meeting. And what other news is important for right now? No, the rest of the news I'm going to keep for tomorrow. But there we go. That's just a nice little happy story. And so very nice. Vutomi. V-U-T-O-M-I, for those who want to know the spelling. Oh, it's just no pleasing you guys. Deborah, the armchair traveler, says the icing on the cake, the cherry on top for the end of the safari would be to pull out a caracal. So we're on caracal hunting now. I will take a bush baby though, I quite like them. But yes, Deborah, it would be absolutely fantastic. I thought I saw a bush baby. Absolutely fantastic to get. Thank you. Thank you very much, stations. I'm crossing back to the north. Great afternoon. Yeah, just. So again, I'm gonna spell it for the third and final time. If you're not listening now, the spelling for Nkanyeni's male cub. Last time we're going to call him that ever. His name is Vutomi, V-U-T-O-M-I. Vutomi is the name of Nkanyeni's male cub. Hopefully we get to see him soon. So this morning, while we were searching the plains of the cheetah, there was Nkanyeni was seen to the north of us in Nkoro, but she was going south. But bad luck for us, good luck for her. She caught a duiker just before the cheetah plains boundary and then dragged it away from our boundary. So we're not probably gonna see her for a while. But you never know, she might make an appearance. Now, the cat streak continues. Now, over a month of cats every single day, isn't that absolutely wonderful? I think the main people we can thank, all the main animals we can thank for that is of course the hashtag incredible Nkahumas. From Jandre and myself, we're going to bathe in the glory of our evening a bit longer while we sedately make our way back towards Juma. We thank you for joining us. We thank you for the questions and comments. And Jandre, can you remember what the word was?
Boink-a-doodle-doo.
There we go. On three.
Boink-a-doodle-doo.
On three, Jandre. Just a little bit. Okay. 1, 2, 3. Boink-a-doodle-doo! Bye. We'll see you in the morning. Back across to Jamie.
And as you can see, we have left Karula for now and are trundling about on our way home after another extraordinary evening here in the African bush. We've left Karula, did just get a little bit too dark when we left. I didn't see any sign of a second cub. I have no doubt though, especially because I think it's the... Actually, I'm not sure which cub is missing. I have no doubt that little cub is alive and well and 100% safe. Just a little separate from the rest of the family. I think they're going to start doing that and spreading further and further afield. And perhaps even acquiring the amazing feigned deafness that teenagers have mastered around the world. Its ability to hear somebody calling but pretend that they didn't. I imagine that it might be quite similar with a Karula and her cubs. She will be waiting there patiently, calling to them, and hopefully tomorrow morning on the sunrise safari, we will have a chance to catch up with her. I'm hoping that she remembers she has a daker there and goes to catch it and put it up, not catch it, it won't require any catching anymore, goes to fetch it and take it up into the jackalberry where she originally stashed it. And of course, as Deborah Armchair Traveller says, perhaps cherry on the cake would be a caracal. James Richard, I thought about the exact same thing, and I actually mentioned it to Viam. Unfortunately, just in terms of distance, we're not going to get there before the end of the sunset safari, but I promise you that I will check that genet nest at some point in the next, probably in the next two or so days. I shouldn't actually promise, because it's so sightings dependent. I could end up on Cheetah Plains, but James Richard is referring to a genet's nest that Viam and myself found. I cannot work out if this is a bush baby or something else. If you zoom in a little bit, Viam, I don't know if I can... What is that? Oh, it's a scrub hare. It's a scrub hare. It's slightly to the left of that. It's a scrub hare. Sorry, scrub hare. Okay, it's definitely not worth stressing over too much. I thought perhaps it was a bush baby on the ground. Definitely not as exciting as I was thinking. Not that scrub hares aren't, just that that view is not very good at all. But yes, I will check the genet's nest. I'm hoping we encounter it again. I must actually get hold of one of Brent's camera traps and set it up there and see if we're correct about my assumption that it's an actual nesting site. You might even get to see little genet babies. I've caught 5 baby genets on a camera trap before. A camera trap, by the way, is not an actual trap. It's a motion-sensored camera. For those of you who think that I'm trapping genets, I'm not. It is a motion-sensored camera that takes a picture when something goes past. And I've seen 5 baby genets with a mother before. Perhaps we could even see that. Who knows? But that is definitely something I will do over the next few days. Just depends on where we happen to end up at the time, at the end of the sunset safari when genets are popping out. I'm excited though. I think that would be amazing if we could sit with it for a long period of time and get it to relax with us and our presence. That would definitely be very special. And so we come up to the end of our sunset safari. What a marvelous sunset safari it has been. One way or another, by hook or by crook, I will be going to Anderson tomorrow morning. I've never seen him before. I'm hoping now that he's got the warthog up in the tree, he will still be there tomorrow and I'll be able to meet him for the first time. I've only ever seen screenshots of him, so I'm very, very eager to have a chance to get to meet him. Heard so many stories and I've tried so many times to track down the Anderson male. Definitely time to make his acquaintance. But we've had a marvelous day, so many different things to see, and of course the marvelous time spent with the Queen and her cubs, who will hopefully be there on the sunrise safari tomorrow morning. For now though, it's time to do our goodbyes and our thank yous. So a big thank you to Viam for his wonderful camera work, and to Kirsty and Jerry in Final Control for keeping us under control. And most importantly, a thank you to all of you watching wherever you happen to find yourself. I do hope you've enjoyed this afternoon's sunset safari and that you are looking forward to many more. Until then, have a wonderful day. Happy Thanksgiving to our Canadian viewers, and we'll see you for the sunrise safari. Bye-bye, everybody.